In this Instructable, we're going to show you how to take a Tiny 26 microprocessor and connect it up to a breadboard, a power supply, and some LEDs. And then we're going to program it to do this little blinking motion. The first thing we need to start with is we need to start with a breadboard. Breadboards come in all sizes. The one on the right's for very large projects, the ones on the left are for smaller projects. Today we're going to use the one in the middle. It's the appropriate size for what we're going to do. This is the breadboard that we're going to use today. If you're not familiar with how a breadboard works internally, there's little metal spring clips, and as you press your component leads into the holes, the spring clips make connections. The red and the blue stripes that you see in the front are connected all the way across. This means that if you connect up something on the left, it will be connected all the way on the right. The red one is going to be 5 volts. The blue lines are going to be our ground. In the center is where we'll connect the chips. At those locations, the connection points run up and down, so that when you plug a chip into it and you plug in a wire next to that pin, it will be properly connected. These are the components that we'll be using today. You recognize, of course, the 9-volt battery and the clip leads. Above the breadboard, you'll see a little diode and a little regulator chip. That's a 7805. It'll convert anywhere from 9 to 36 volts into the 5 volts that we need. Next to that are two different types of straight pins. They're called a SIP, single inline pin, and they're very handy. We'll learn about those shortly. And to the far right are two capacitors. They will act to buffer and filter out any fluctuating voltages from when the LEDs that we attach are turning on and turning off rapidly. To make our power connection, we need to plug the two leads from the clip leads into the breadboard. But there's a problem. The clip leads are stranded wires, and stranded wires won't go into the breadboard very well. To remedy that, we're going to solder on a couple of pins as shown here. Once the pins are firmly soldered into place, we can press them into the breadboard and start adding our components. The two pins that we've used will make sure that there's a good secure anchor and that they're not going to come loose as we move the breadboard around and experiment with it. Now that the power leads are laid in place, we've added the rest of the components for our power supply. You'll notice that the diode is connected to the positive lead from the battery with the silver stripe against the power regulator chip. That means that if we accidentally connect the battery backwards, no current will flow, so we won't damage the circuit. For connecting up the circuits, solid wire of 22 to 24 gauge is best. One source of this is if you can find a telephone repair person, a lot of times they'll have a little extra cable left at the end of the spool. Even a short piece is wonderful, as you can pull the jacket off and there's plenty of wires inside for you to experiment with. Just so that we know when our circuit is powered or not, we're going to connect up an LED and a resistor. The resistor is there to protect the LED from being burned out from too much voltage, and we'll explain that in the Instructable. Here you see everything all wired up with the battery, and everything's working perfectly. The LED is glowing, so we're ready to begin and start adding the microprocessor to the circuit. Now that we've built the power supply, we're going to flip the board around so that the power supply is on the right-hand side, and we're going to plug the little Atmel Tiny 26 microprocessor in, starting with its pin 1 on column number 10 of the breadboard. And this is simply to give us some room to the left to install the programmer later. We next install a couple of power leads on the microprocessor. And after that, we're going to prep up the Sparkfun programming adapter board. We add the pins to it, and this is where we're going to make our connections from our programming cable to the Atmel Tiny 26 for programming. Now that we've got the breakout board assembled, we're going to place it on the breadboard where we want it to go so that we can note which pins need to be connected. First thing we're going to do is connect the power pins. We're using the yellow and the green wire. I'm getting them from a jumper wire kit. These are very handy to have. Once we've established where it's going, we make the remaining connections, and then we're able to put the programmer onto the board. At this point, everything is set and we could actually program the chip. It wouldn't be very useful right now because nothing's connected, but it would actually program. Here you can see that the entire board is connected. We've got our power supply connected. You can see the little red LED is illuminated. That lets us know everything is fine and the chip is ready to be programmed. So the next step is to plug the cable in and send it our program. Here you can see we have BASCOM loaded. We're going to click on Options, Compiler, and Chip. Then what we're going to do is go down to here and we're going to look for Tiny26. And there it is in the list. We'll click on that. And that sets the parameters that are needed for the chip. We click Add to Code, and it's going to drop that into our code. Now you can see here that it's put all the information in there for us. Now there's a minor problem, and that's that we're going to run the chip at 1 MHz and it defaults to 4, so we need to change that. Once that's changed, we've got all the information that we need to send a basic program out to the chip. At this point it wouldn't do very much, but the chip would program and the software knows how to communicate with it. Okay, at this point we've just added in some programming code here. First thing I've done is a configuration statement. It's going to tell it that port A should be an output, and we're also going to tell it that port B should be an output. This particular chip, the Tiny26, has two ports, and we've just set them both to outputs because we're going to be connecting up some LEDs and so forth. You can also set them up for an input in case you wanted to hook a switch. Now, if you look here, it says port B.0, port B.1, port B.2, those are the actual chips, but we're going to use the alias command. We're going to give them another name. In this case, we're going to give them red, yellow, and green. It's a lot easier to remember. And in our code, then we can say red equals 1, and the light will be turned on, the LED will be turned on. Or we can say, you know, yellow equals 0 or green equals 0, and we can turn the LEDs on or off as we choose. Down here you see there's some wait commands, and then we've come down to the next line and we've set it up, and then the following line. So we've got three different settings that we're going to do for the LEDs and have them go in sequence over and over again. Once we have our program, the next thing that we need to do is to get it into the chip. Before we do that, I want to make a little change here. We're going to change these wait 1 seconds to wait milliseconds. Millisecond is 1/1000th of a second, so 100 milliseconds is 1/10th of a second. And I'm going to use Control C to copy and then Control V to paste it in. So now that we've done that, it'll blink a lot faster. It'll go every 1/10th of a second, so it'll be really interesting to look at. So now we're ready to go and compile this into a program that we can load into the chip. So we click on the Compile button. Now, since we haven't saved this before, it's going to ask us for a name, and I'm going to call it Instrcutables. So we'll type that in here, and then when we're done, we'll hit Save, and it will save it. It'll ask me if I want to keep the configuration file. That's fine, and it's compiled it with no errors. The next thing we do is we come up to this little green button and click on it, and what it will do is it'll go out to the programmer, and it will connect up and it'll bring up the programming window. Once we have the programming window, we simply click on the green button and it's going to load that software that you see here, that gobbledygook, into the chip. And that's what the chip needs to make it work. And that's pretty much it. You disconnect the cable and the chip will continue to run the program. And here it is, functioning perfectly. You can see it starts with the red LED, then the yellow, then the green, and it recycles over and over again. I hope you've enjoyed this, and I hope you've learned something. Please vote for this Instrcutable. I'd love to win the Sparkfun Challenge. Thank you.